it's like I'm geared up, like I'm going to give a very different presentation, like I'm going to impersonate a digital city. I'm not. But I will ask you first. Who has ever heard about a digital city? Aha, yay, that's quite a lot, so I'm going to ask the next question. Who actually had an email address at the digital city? So we have two left now. Okay, for the refrigerator, who did have a house in the digital city? Now I've lost you. Okay, well, at least I'm very happy to know that people know about the digital city, because let's get digging in the past now. This is our challenge. But first, my name is Stella Haan. I work for the Amsterdam Museum. So this project we do with the Amsterdam Museum. And our biggest goal is to reconstruct and safeguard digital heritage of Amsterdam. And our biggest challenge is a website, what is taken offline in 2001. How can we bring it together? How can you find it? Where is it? And then how to reconstruct it? It has been gone as a virtual Atlantis, and at least what we try to hope of it, to make of it, is a virtual Pompeii. Amsterdam Museum, very nice museum, go there. Now some images of the past. Right was the telephone number you would phone to call in, and under you see the first cityscape, landscape of the digital city, and as you see, it is a bulletin board system that was started in 94. And here you see the Prins Hendrikade, which is holy ground for the DDS people, because there they opened the street, put the phone lines in. Yes? Okay, my favorite cartoonist was digging in his own files, and then, oh my God, I wrote poetry in my past. There are many reasons that the museum started this project, and one is help our digital heritage is getting lost. And this is the urgency why we do it. In 2003, the UNESCO already wrote a chapter how to preserve our digital heritage. Brewster Kahle, you know, of the Wayback Machine, the Internet Archive, started in 96. So some parts of the digital city are there. But as we know, the Wayback Machine, the Internet Archive, make snapshots, make photos. So small representations of the website, but not all. And Brewster Kahle said, well, the web was not designed to be preserved. And that is what we have to give our future creators and future developers, how to create a website which can be preserved. And Finn Cerf, of course, our hero, because of he was the inventor of some protocols which built the internet. He said, if we don't watch out, we are going to lose some decades of our history because it is digital. So I made a summary of all our problems we have in this project. And first, it starts with born digital. What is it? Where does it begin? Where does it end? What is it? And how does it work? And methods. There are already some projects coming close to our project. But web archaeology is still a rare sort. We're not making snapshots. We really want to represent the past, the digital city, how it was. And then many problems we have. There are no web archaeological tools yet. There is no repository for tools. If you need a reader or a converter, where is it? And we need a software library. A library has advantages because they can deal different than commercial parties or single persons. So somebody must be making that software library so you can always go back. And we need a big e-depot where we can store our data. And I call this project a slow data project because we're already digging up the digital city from 2011 and still digging. And if we don't watch out, we are digging longer than the city actually existed. Now, two different approaches, because what happened for the museum We normally have paintings or nice physical objects, and now we are doing some born digital data. And here you see the oldest view of Amsterdam, and the right is the newest view of Amsterdam from the 20th century in a bulletin board system. So the museum has to find new ways. How do we deal with born digital? And first, we have to dig it up and then reconstruct. But then what we do with the data? We are not data specialists. So the whole open archive information system traject, we are going to work. If we have the data, where will we put it? And how to manage it? And that's completely new. But then now I'll take you back to the digital city. It was the first virtual city in the world. And it was the first online community in Holland. So pre-Facebook, even pre-Hives. And it brought internet to the public. So if you were not a military or studying at the academics, you could now enter internet. And it is really telling the story of Amsterdam. It's a fluid group who created the digital city. It started with Marleen Sticker at the Bali, a political cultural center, debating, and they thought, hey, in America, there's a lot going on with debating, online debating. Try and find out what they're doing and try to bring it to the Bali. And Marleen started talking to some people who were already acting with computers, doing something, knowing something of computers, and those were the hackers. They went to different parties, but then they thought of, okay, what are we going to make? How are we going to do those debates in Amsterdam? And they knew there were elections coming up in the city of Amsterdam. And then they made a combination, a digital city. And because of this metaphor, they could incorporate something what was completely unknown to the widest audience. What is the internet? What are those computers? And what is being online? And because of this metaphor of a city where people actually could go to the post office to read their mail, their email, could go to the central station, go online, and go worldwide, it attracted a lot of attention, and modems were sold out the day after the digital city was online. So it had a huge, it was very popular. And you can't compare it with Facebook, but in 2000, they had 140,000 inhabitants. And that was a lot at those times, at those years. Well, for you know, it is quite there for a few years now, the internet and the World Wide Web. And the digital city is now 22 years ago that it was arisen. Those are the three the cityscapes. And the digital city followed the new technologies. So they started with the bulletin board system, and then Mosaic came, and it was the first graphical browser. So you see the red one, and then they started to think how to be interactive in a city, and they invented the third most known cityscape, and that is with squares and houses. And the idea of the digital city was you could become a member, you can get an account, but then they called it you will be an inhabitant and you can get your own house. And your own house was your website. So people start building houses like crazy with their interests. And so that's why it is a treasury of born digital heritage. People really lived their life. Children are born there. Actual physical children, because DDS was also kind of first dating website. People met in the chats and, in real life, they called it as well. They went to the pubs because you had different ways of meeting each other. So culturally seen, it's a very interesting city. Newly created, people discussing with each other how to deal with debates online, how to act between them, what you could do in the city, what you couldn't do. Can you squat houses? Why would you squat a house in a virtual community? Well, those days, hosting prices were rocket high. So there was not a lot of space bought. And then people started hacking into each other's houses, and they had even a squat rule, a law of squatting, what you could do or not. So all new rules were created at the moment, at the fly. And, well, Digital City was like a playground. They experimented with technology, and as well they experimented with debating and how to act and deal with each other. And these are the most important interfaces, different technologies, and every time getting closer to the idea of the city. Now, what do we want? RAID-ADS means the reconstruction of the digital city. We want to keep the internet historical monument, as we call it, and map the history, and as well, this is a pilot for web archaeology. Because how do you do that? The website's no longer online. Where is it? And then, if you have data, what to do with it? And in the tradition of the digital city, a lot of handbooks were written, very Dutch. and that's what we want to do. We also now starting a project, because this is a project you can't do alone. We have certain knowledge, but we need the expertise and knowledge and manpower of other institutions. So now we work with the Institution of Sound and Vision, the Waag Society, University of Amsterdam, and the NCDD, a nice abbreviation for the Nationale Coalitie Digitaal Duurzaam, something with national coalition and sustainable digital, yeah, precies, exact. Because last year there was launched this national strategy, how to deal with our digital heritage. And there are three lines for the NCDD, visible, usable, and preservable. So what you can do with data, there are these three lines. And we are accepted in the line of preservable, because we have data. And now, how to deal with it and store with it. And what we want to do in doing the process that we are doing, what I will explain later, is writing a do-it-yourself handbook. If you have any wishes or ideas how to dig up some really old data, we hope we could give you our ideas so you don't make the blunders we did. So what are we doing? How do we do it? You start excavating. You want to make the data accessible, the reconstruction and presentation, and the finish. And now we started in the Waag with a grave diggers party. We invited all the old system administrators of the digital city, old inhabitants, and everybody who had something with the digital city, and then clear out your attic, bring your old disks, bring anything physical you've left from the digital city. Come and drink a beer with us and tell your stories. What were we looking for? A lot of software, a lot of hardware, special projects, special web project, hybrid projects, because in Amsterdam there was this independent culture of media broadcasting, so there were a lot of programs between the digital city and the Salto television, and there were a lot of hybrid programs. Like games were broadcasted live, and then under there was a chat. Like it was really a sport event of, and a journalist would give comments to the gamers. This was the Grave Diggers party, and we made it appear like a little like CSI, like there's a huge accident here. Data are lost, and how do we find it? We had system administrators who would get the data of old computers or from old tapes. And in the end, we collected like 45 gigabytes on data, raw data. data you can't give to somebody because you can't do anything with that. But what we do, we also showed the findings we had in like a temporary exhibition, and we worked there for 3 weeks. People could get in and out, and so we found 45 gigabytes of raw data. We found a freeze, I will show later on, and we found these old public terminals. I'll show you now with a lot of... And these, we found a smart TV. There were 4 episodes and about digital culture. And the first one is about opening the digital city. And it is really, you need to be, you have to have a lot of time because each episode is like 6 hours, like almost like Fidel Castro, but keep hanging in there. It's really cool to see because a lot of people of those times who were busy with building the digital city were interviewed and they really gave their ideas and visionary and some are already incorporated in our lives and we don't know when they were invented, but it's just daily life for us. And some you think, were they really thinking that it would happen? So we have those episodes on our website of the museum, and it's really fun to see. It's like a web course. How do they thought the web would grow? Now, these were donated to us at this gravediggers party. These, and there are actually 2 of them, these were the public terminals. Because of the, I told you, the Bali and the hackers came together and somebody had to pay the bunch, so the city of Amsterdam was involved and asked, would you like to pay for the digital city? And I thought, working with hackers, is that really sensible to do, sensitive to do? But they did. 2 times they paid 100,000 guilders for a 10-week experiment for the digital city. And they had a few conditions, like we want to put as much documents online about the elections coming so people can read it. So to read it, and as well, because nobody had a computer or internet in those days, we want something public people can go to and experience this cyberspace, this internet. So 6 of these public terminals were put in the city, at the hospital, the city hall, as well in the museum, and people would sit in the chair and then they could, on the terminal, they could enter the digital city. And at one point, it got so popular because the gamers found out that there were really queues behind the chairs. So then they wrote a script. You can only be online for 30 minutes, and then you're thrown off so the next can come in. Now I'm going to show you some slides of digital and physical things we have found in our time of digging. This is the first city visualization, but this one could not be online because there was no interaction, no clicking possible. So they opened Digital City with a bulletin board system. These magazines we found in the museum, in the library. I'm very happy about it. And you can see the special design of that time. Also very progressive. A lot of leaflets, and these you can read, we scanned those, you can read all at the museum site. The design of the squares, and of course you also had the Square of the Dead. And, well, this is what somebody sent to us. This is a memorial, somebody died, and in the names you also see the names of the surfers who said goodbye to the person. Marlene Sticker is cutting the cake of the 1-year anniversary of the digital city. You see Felipe Rodriguez on the right. He recently passed, alas, but he was the founder of Access for All, but he also founded, with others, the digital city. And actually, he created the first bulletin board system. So now, beautiful, really great design, you can see. But we found these hardware. And most were cannibalized. I'm not sure if you are familiar with the term, but all working elements of the surface were taken off because it was so expensive at that time. So everything, every part of the server was reused. But we found all these hardware and we store it. Maybe we can do something nice with it. Then we hit the lottery because after the Gravediggers party, Joost Flint, the former owner of the Digital City, came to me. Yes, I've got something here. And those were the three DLT tapes. And he said, yeah, I'm not sure what it is, but here, this is the data. And I read on the Wayback Machine that there was this freeze when the Digital City was having its second anniversary in 96. They gave themselves a birthday present in a freeze. And a freeze is like a painting. It's a still life at that moment, 5 minutes. Oh, okay. the freeze. So we had the tapes. It was a freeze of the software, the data, and the hardware they promised us, I read in the Wayback Machine. And then we had only three tapes. But when you have three tapes, you don't have the tape reader. So it took me a year to get the right tape reader and to get the data from the tapes. And these are all the heroes who worked with that. And happily to announce that you can come to the museum and you can see the really first web archaeological artifact in the museum, because the funny figures you see, those are the avatars. When you got a house in a digital city, when you got an account, you got an avatar, because there were no cameras, digital cameras at the time, and nobody was very handy in drawing something for yourself. And with this picture, you would have your unique personality and representation into the city. So we dug up of the tapes, we dug up the avatars, everybody got one, and we opened this last year in a museum, and we are celebrating it. If you come, please tell me. I make a photo, and you will be in the Hall of Fame. Now, I have 3 minutes left, probably. Web archaeology is a very particular and strange hobby. We use all techniques, data recovery, digital forensics, e-discovery, and a lot more. And I can explain more if you would like. But now we are very happy. In this process of web archaeology, this slow data project, we are not close to the end yet. We have a representation now into the museum, but we have this raw data and we want them to be in the e-depots, because the e-depots in the Netherlands, those guys and girls, those how to deal with data and to preserve it for the future. And then we could, no, not rest, because then we have another archaeological things to dig up, but then we would be really happy, because then we know the past will be preserved for the future. Students and volunteers are digging up. We actually found software and we get it working again. So, well, preserve the internet historical monuments. Okay, we have already something in the museum we're happy about. But then, how to reconstruct the digital city? Are we able to reconstruct it? Will the data be helpful to us? Do we have clever guys and girls who can reconstruct it technologically? And then can we preserve it in the e-depot? And then, well, we will definitely write a handbook with all the trial and errors. That's hopefully in time.